nuclear access. It's all math. But what's the definition of EIN in his paper? It's very simple. And honestly, when this came out, we thought all of us will use it. But the gynecologist didn't like it, and the pathologist did not pick on it for some reason. Now look how, if you read this, this is so simple. So look at this. The architecture, any area, any increase, gland greater than stroma, cytology differed from the normal. As simple as that. Size, more than 1 millimeter. And you exclude the mimics, any benign condition that I talked about, and you exclude the cancer. So anything abnormal more than 1 millimeter. Life is so simple. And believe me, in the reproducibility work that they looked at, they agreed, like three pathologists, they agreed together on it. And you remember that when I start my lectures, I give you the definition of precursor lesion, and it fulfilled the criteria completely. And when they looked at EIN and compared it to a typical hyperplasia and complex non-atypical hyperplasia or simple hyperplasia, it's the majority of cases overlap with a typical complex hyperplasia. Okay? And the reproducibility, it was really high, very high, among three pathologists, like close to one. And looking at the progression to carcinoma, the black dot, this is follow-up of this patient. This is in simple hyperplasia, complex non-atypia, complex with atypia. Most of the patient developed carcinoma in this category. So this is in the hyperplasia scheme, and this is in the EIN scheme. All of this patient in the dark dot, they were in the EIN. So, say life is beautiful, this is a great criteria, and we should all use it, but it was not used. But the progression from EIN to carcinoma was similar to a typical complex hyperplasia. So, how do we use it, and if we want to maximize, you know, learning from this criteria? Whenever I'm in doubt between simple and complex, and I'm more toward a typical complex hyperplasia, but I cannot put hands on it 100%, I use the word atypical hyperplasia, and it is identical to EIN, and this is what a lot of pathologists they use. So this is why I thought I'll introduce this terminology. And management, the same as a typical complex hyperplasia. In young patients, you do progesterone therapy. In elderly or older patients, they are done with their fertility. It is hysterectomy, TH with DSO. These are a step before. And again, it's in the literature. Sometimes I use it, sometimes I not. Again, I like to use endometrial glandular and architectural disarray more than endometrial gland crowding. A term introduced by Dr. Nucci from Mass General. And she looked at so many endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial biopsy using this term, endometrial gland crowding, and she followed them up. Only a very small percentage, they developed carcinoma, and I believe that was from sampling. They didn't do good sampling. And 19%, they had EIN, and the rest were benign. Just a picture from their paper. Okay, it's a little bit crowding, and I'm sure you all looked at this, and probably you put a comment on it. So what's the management for this? What is it? Remember everything we put in our report, it is for our surgeon what to do with the patient. They do not do anything, they follow up this patient. They bring the patient back in 6 months. Okay. I'm moving in the second part of my talk about progestational therapy. What do we see? What changes should we focus on? How do we deal with this biopsy? Any questions regarding hyperplasia? You're okay? No. So, the stroma decentralization, remember, in the progestational therapy, this is the first thing get affected, and then you'll see epithelial changes in the nuclear and in the architecture, both of them. So the nuclear, it become round, very bland. Like you say, what happened to this nuclei? It was in the proliferative phase, very coarse chromatin, it was with mitosis, but suddenly after the treatment, they become very bland, very, there's no atypia at all. And the marked decrease in the mitotic figures, barely you see any. And metaplasia a lot, these cells become pink. And more cytoplasmic, eosinophilic cytoplasmic. You might see some mucins and secretory and squamous. Decrease in the glandular cellularity, it shrink completely. And you see the complete, and the confluent group reform not present anymore. Remember these patients, either they have well-differentiated endometrial carcinoma or a typical complex hyperplasia. Cystic change resembles cystic atrophy. So this is complete presentational effect. Okay? So if I have this, I call it endometrial biopsy with a presentational effect, including decidualization of the stroma and inactive glands. They are like the epithelium completely bland. And this is what the aim after the therapy. This is complete regression of the lesion. Stromal decidualization. This is a well-differentiated carcinoma. You agree? The papillary projections, mitosis everywhere. There are those here. This is very well. There is no stratification around. So let's see after treatment what happened. This is post-treatment. Do they all respond 100%? Let's see how we do deal with whenever they do not respond. But you got a lot of mucin. You got a mucinous metaplasia even here, but look at the nuclei. They become very round, very atrophic. I don't have stratification, no mitosis. But you need both the nuclear and the architecture to respond. This is after the treatment. I'm not saying this responds 100%, but remember we start getting the cystic dilated more, mucin and metaplasia, no mitosis. Residual disease, so it did not respond. What do I see? In project, we call it progesterone-treated simple hyperplasia. When I have no cytologic ectopia, I'm sorry, complex cystic hyperplasia, back-to-back gland or confluent and other papillary pattern, but no cytologic ectopia. This is treated, but still, its lesion is there. This is progesterone-treated complex atypical hyperplasia, no cytologic ectopia, back-to-back lightning confluent pattern. Simple atypical hyperplasia, it's from the word atypical, still the atypical the cytology is there, and they are spaced in glass. So the architecture got affected, but the ectopia not. Progesterone-treated carcinoma, well, it is still carcinoma. You got the ectopia and the architecture together. So it does not respond all the time. And I believe the way they follow up the patient every 6 months, they do endometrial correctings till they see the complete response. And this is the residual disease from Blaustein. Progesterone-treated complex hyperplasia, so no cytologic ectopia, but crowded back-to-back gland. Progesterone-treated complex atypical hyperplasia, still you see the cytologic ectopia, so still the criteria for atypical hyperplasia is here, and the progesterone-treated well-differentiated carcinoma, I still have the ectopia, and the confluent cribriform carcinoma. So look at this. This is the carcinoma, pre-treatment. Look at the nuclear features. Still, it's post-treatment. It did not reflect that well, but it's better than here. Bland nuclear ectopia. Okay? Barely, we know. So what's the predictor of failure of response to treatment? Nuclear ectopia at 6 months. If I still see the nuclear ectopia, they did not respond. Nuclear ectopia prior to the treatment does not affect it. Okay? So what's the diagnostic point? It's the confluent architecture associated with blend psychology is not indicative of failure of response to treatment. So we put more weight of the psychological activity here than the architecture. Progesterone treatment typically results in bland nuclei and deductible mitotic activity and a variety of metaplastic changes. Whenever you see it, it is responding. So pre-treatment biopsy always must be seen and evaluated. So whenever I have a progesterone treatment biopsy, I always ask for the pre-treatment to look at both of them and compare how was the treatment going or working or what changes I'm seeing. Did it respond? Because whenever you have the baseline, you can evaluate this, like what's the treatment effect. Treatment should be continuing until there is no evidence of residual disease. Okay? And consider, like this is where what we tell, consider discontinuing progesterone treatment if nuclear ectopia is present in 6 months, or it's not responding. And some patients, they do not respond. Even if successfully treated, lesion can recur, particularly in young women. So it is not treatment for life. It's only they give the patient a break if they want to have children. And this is, I know, a busy slide, but I'll tell you about no progestational therapy and progestational therapy. And the progression, I cannot see from here, the progression, this is the complex atypical hyperplasia, 70 cases. And if you go down, some of them regression, like number 44, with no treatment, it was 33%. With treatment, 73%, they regress. They regress. And the other one, the one they persist or progress to carcinoma, 67 without treatment versus 27. I mean, this really big difference. Okay? So the home take message, pick the previous before treatment biopsy if available. Yeah, most of the time this is what we do. Okay, so we are ready for some quiz. Any question? Let's see if you answer me. Again, by raising hand, we go through this. Look at, this is the entire slide. I put it here. And I don't know if you can appreciate this. Some of them, they have complete treatment effect, and then I'm focusing on this one here. Like, this is the top, and this is down here. So this is, you can tell, a lot of eosinophilic changes and gland-looking nuclei. So this is post-treatment. I'm focusing more, as I said, on this focus. Post-treatment, but what would you call this? What do you think you should call it? I mean, it is with treatment effect, but what still I have? Group reforming. The nuclei were okay, but the architecture did not pick it up. It was not responding 100%. So there is no complete regression. Okay, still it's post-treatment, and this is what I believe, what I call post-treatment adenocarcinoma. Okay? Persistent, well-differentiated adenocarcinoma. Because of the group reforming of the glands, still, it did not respond. Only the nuclear ectopia was. And some of them actually still, you see nucleoli, so was not responding. Yeah. It was bland, different from the original, but not still. It's, there is nuclear ectopia, nucleoli here, pleomorphism. Exactly. Okay. So this is in the differential diagnosis of the hyperplasia. What do you call this hyperplasia? Okay, let's start with this. Who would call this simple hyperplasia? Raise your hand. Okay? Who would call this complex hyperplasia? Okay? and who would call this is another, so just to be fair. And guess what's this? This drama in complex hyperplasia is very condensed, very busy. Even this drama is proliferating. This is critical. Let's say 35 years old, presenting with vaginal bleeding, and this is what we got. There are two things here. We got the surface, what would I call this? What would I call under the surface? And I have a lesion here. And this is, I know it's not fair, it's low power, and I'll go high power. All right. So, is this, number one, sensational metaplasia. Who would call it sensational metaplasia? Who would call this complex hyperplasia? It's a lot of papillary production. I mean, let me go, that's a lot of papillary production. You know, no matter what. So, complex hyperplasia? How about hyperplasia? Come on, guys, I might trick you here, you know, it's not all of them denied. Let's see, it is complex hyperplasia. It's a lot of papillary projections. We cannot ignore the architecture. It is no atypia, but it is. It's a lot of eosinophil changes. And the trick, I agree, the trick it is, there is breakdown, and there is sensorial hyperplasia. You picked up that. That's beautiful at the top, yes. And that was the tricky way that I led you through. But down here is the lesion. You cannot ignore this. This is too much, okay? And I cannot fit it. And remember, I mean, there is no nothing written on stone that I have to follow 100%. There is always the gray zone that you can call it endometrial hyperplasia C comet. A lot of papillary projections with eosinophilic changes. Okay? This is the way I would handle it. I believe I have one more. This is again 40 years old with all of them with bleeding, right? There is no history there. Look at this. I know it's very low power. The stroma, the key, the answer is in the stroma, it's low power. So from this power, I would say simple hyperplasia. Okay. Complex. Polyp? Okay, let's go higher power. What's in here? Right. It's the smooth muscles. It's the same image I put. I felt like, let's see how many people would need. Okay? It's the smooth muscles infiltrating through. And they are very irregular shaped. They are not cystically dilated. They don't have papillary projection. Most of them, they are irregular, as if they are infiltrating. But they're not. A lot of squamous. Smooth muscles and some squamous. So it is a typical polypoid. It is, but we don't emphasize on it. Exactly. And the question is, there is hyperplasia, element of hyperplasia. This is from it is. There is an element of hyperplasia. And the treatment, most of the time, they do hysterectomy if the patient is old enough. Yes. Very good. And I believe this is the end of this talk. Any question?
Please. I have one.
Okay. Can we answer first from the audience and then I'll go to the audience? Go ahead.
You had the mic?
Very good questions. Like, do you use the term glandular and stromal breakdown? You could use any term you like. Sometimes I call it with focal shedding. I would say inactive endometrial biopsy with focal shedding. Or shedding endometrium, see comment. Whatever term you use, it's indication for breakdown. So it doesn't matter. Some pathologists, they use breakdown, it's fine, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
It's very confusing. I know that the progestational effect is very confusing. For me, you need both to have persistent, well-differentiated endometrial carcinoma. You need the activity and the architecture. But if I lost the architecture and kept the ectopia, I would call it treated complex atypical hyperplasia, right? Because you have the ectopia and you don't have the architecture. So you think about what's the definition of atypical complex hyperplasia. If I have ectopia and no architecture for carcinoma, but architecture for complex hyperplasia, I would lower it down. So it got treated. Look at its scale. Is it carcinoma? No, it went a step below complex hyperplasia, but still the treatment there, so I'll mention it. Yeah. Yes, this is why you need to review the previous. So the previous was carcinoma, but it got affected, it went down to complex hyperplasia. They might still treat the patient because there is some effect. So they go another 6 months and then re-biopsy. Was the treatment more effective? Did it go lower or not? Sometimes you will not have the entire, actually the second, it's a lecture by itself talking about this. Like you see what time, how many cycles you need, what's the treatment in every cycle, how many cases persist. And remember, it's all study and reviewing what's the data in that study. So how many cases persist, how many cases regress. So you just, as a pathologist, I never speculate. I describe what's in the slide. We cannot do like that. Stromal sarcoma and, I fully agree, and it's a wonderful question. Using the smooth muscle immunohistochemistry panel with endometrial stromal sarc, this is the question. It's H&E, and take more sections because there is, again, it's another lecture, and we get confused between endometrial stromal sarc and serous carcinoma, but that's okay. In endometrial stromal sarc, there is two variants. There is endometrial stromal sarc with smooth muscle variant, and there is endometrial stromal sarc with endometrial glandular variant. Believe it or not, you see glands, or you see smooth muscles. Here, when it gets really muddy, it's exactly, the immunohistochemistry will be the same. But remember the way endometrial stromal sarc, the way it should grow. So when you look at the slide, you see this like a round following the blood vessels, very cellular, very bland cytology with mitosis, a lot of mitosis. In leiomyosarcoma, you need the cytologic ectopia. Remember what I talked about? And you need the necrosis. In endometrial stromal sarc, you don't have this too. Okay? So there is this, and again, it is your judgment, and we show the cases. I don't want to put an advertisement like send me the case, but we show the cases among each other.
Too small,
right. Absolutely, it is very helpful. In leiomyosarcoma, they have thicker blood vessels, you know. And you do your best. At the end, you do your best. Okay? I hope I answered your question. Sorry, go ahead. For your question.
I have a question about the classification of hyperplasia.
Okay.
Do we classify it as hyperplasia with a tibia and hyperplasia without a tibia and full stop, or just we still use the four-type classification, simple with a tibia or without, and complex with and without? Because I know that since 2014, there is a new classification. It is hyperplasia with or hyperplasia without.
Again, it depends which center do you work. I still use simple and complex, and not only me, in the state, we still keep that simple hyperplasia without the tibia, simple hyperplasia. It's in the WHO to keep it. Sometimes you cannot tell, you call it endometrial hyperplasia with or without. Again, it depends who's on the other end, who's your gynecologist.
Yeah.
You don't want, like, it's only simple hyperplasia and you get hysterectomy out of it. Literally, they go as far as hysterectomy. You don't want to get a patient with simple hyperplasia that it will not progress to carcinoma, only 3%, to get hysterectomy out of it. I mean, it's a big procedure, hysterectomy. So yes, we keep the entire thing.
So it depends on the centers and how they are treated.
By WHO, I believe it is still simple and complex hyperplasia with or without ectopia. Only I keep the word endometrial hyperplasia or complex hyperplasia whenever I cannot tell. You know, it is lacking something that I cannot go full-fledged and typical complex hyperplasia, or I have the simple and the complex, but a lot of complex. So I say what I see, exactly. I call it complex hyperplasia or hyperplasia with a CPSC comment. I always explain what I mean in my diagnosis. It's very helpful. And we always say, oh, surgeons don't read. Believe me, they read. They really read every word we write.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Roper. It was a very enlightening lecture and excellent. All the practical points are very helpful for us. But I want to ask, do you grade a typical hyperplasia? Do you say severe or mild or moderate? Just atypical?
Yeah, only atypical. The word atypical is, sometimes if I have only one gland atypical, I'm like, really, I have to say, what about, you know, you are in doubt. Whenever I'm in doubt, first thing, the cheapest thing to do, go recount. It's the most helpful thing to me and to all of us, and so cheap. Do recut. You have one atypical gland, you're not sure, and remember, it's hysterectomy. Get it on? So I go recut. If I have more glands, then yes, it is full-fledged atypical complex hyperplasia. If I lost that gland, then, you know, I'll let it go. If the gland persists, I would call it was focal, but I do not grade that tibia.
You don't grade? Because sometimes they say, if you say severe and difficult hyperplasia, they go for hysterectomy, and if you say mild or moderate, they treat the patient.
No. They, again, treatment is the same. A typical complex hyperplasia, no matter what. I mean, if it is severe enough, you could say it was foci of one fifth. You know what I mean? But it's very severe. Let's say you are pulling it. You could say in that comment, all the glands revealed a tibia. But we do not agree with it.
And for if you have foci of carcinoma, you said you go for treatment if she's in the fertile period. And as we usually know from the literature that carcinoma is more severe and the prognosis is worse with younger age. So you still keep her on treatment for some time, and you're not afraid that it will progress.
Again, it's how long the treatment will go, it's up to the surgeon, and they follow up every 6 months. So if you get 2-6 months and the ectopia is still there, well, the patient is not responding, so they'll stop the treatment. You know, and again, this is a completely different criteria and different time, like how many cycles they use. And I yesterday I did the gynecologist.